In total reality, he comes in the form of the beggar, in the form of the dissolute human child in ragged clothes. He comes asking for help. Jesus confronts you and every person that you meet. As long as there are people, Christ will walk on the earth as your neighbor. Through him and him, God calls you, speaks to you, makes demands of you. That is the great seriousness and the great blessedness of the Advent message. Christ is standing at the door, your door. He lives in the form of the human being among us. Do you want to close the door or open it? It may strike us as strange to see Christ in such a familiar face, but he said it, and those who withdrew from the serious reality of the Advent message cannot talk of the coming of Christ in their heart without recognizing this. Christ is knocking. It's still not Christmas, but it's also still not the great last Advent, the final coming of Christ. Through all the Advents of our life that we celebrate, there runs the longing for the last Advent when we'll see Jesus make all things new. The Advent season is a season of waiting, but our whole life is an Advent season that is a season of waiting for the last Advent, for the time when there will be a new heaven and a new earth.
Thank you.
living by God's mercy, by Jesus on offer. We cannot approach the manger of the Christ child in the same way we approach the cradle of another child. Rather, when we go to his manger, something happens and we cannot leave it again unless we have been judged or redeemed. Here we must either collapse or know the mercy of God directed towards us. What does this mean? It isn't all of this just a way of speaking. Isn't it just pastoral exaggeration of a pretty and pious legend? What does it mean that such things are said about the Christ child? Those who want to take it as a way of speaking will do so and continue to celebrate Advent and Christmas as before, with pagan indifference. For us, it is not just a way of speaking, for that's just it. It is God, Godself, the Lord and the Creator of all things, who is so small here, who is hidden there in the corner, who enters into the blamelessness of the world, who meets us in the helplessness and the defenselessness of a child, and wants to be with us. And he does this not out of playfulness or sport, because we find that so touching, but in order to show us where he is and who he is, and in order from this place to judge and devalue and dethrone all human ambition. The throne of God in the world is not on human thrones, but in human depths in the manger. Standing around his throne, there are no flattering vassals, but dark, unknown, questionable figures who cannot get their fear of this miracle and want to live entirely by the mercy of God.
Thank you. congregation is invited to sing the next two carols printed in your worship folder.
God We Hardly Knew by Oscar Romero. No one can celebrate a genuine Christmas without being truly poor. The self-sufficient, the proud, those who, because they have everything, look down on others, those who have no need even of God. For them, there will be no Christmas. Only the poor, the hungry, those who need someone to come on their behalf will have that someone. That someone is God, Emmanuel, God with us. Without poverty of spirit, there can be no abundance of God.
With his hand to make a home. Thank you.
Christian painters have created for the Son of David, as if ashamed that their God should have lain down in poverty and dirt. And not the modern Christmas Eve holy stable, either, made of plaster of Paris, with little candy-like statuettes, the holy stable, clean and prettily painted, with a neat, tidy manger, an ecstatic ass, a contrite ox, and angels fluttering their wreaths on the roof. This is not the stable where Jesus was born. A real stable is the house, the prison of the animals who worked for man. The poor old stable of Christ's old poor country is only four rough walls, a dirty pavement, a roof of beams and slate. It is dark, reeking. The only clean thing in it is the manger, where the owner piles the hay and fodder. Fresh in the clear morning, waving in the wind, sunny, lush, sweet-scented, the spring meadow was mowed. The green grass, the long, slim blades were cut down by the side. And with the grass, the beautiful flowers in full bloom, white, red, yellow, blue, they withered and dried and took on the one dull color of hay. Oxen dragged back to the barn the dead plunder of May and June. And now that grass has become dry hay, and those flowers, still smelling sweet, are there in the manger to feed the slaves of man. The animals take it slowly with their great black lips, and later the flowering fields, changed into moist dung, return to the light on the litter which serves as bedding. This is the real stable where Jesus was born. The filthiest place in the world was the first room of the only pure man ever born of woman. The Son of Man, who was to be devoured by wild beasts calling themselves men, had as his first cradle the manger where the animals chewed the cud of the miraculous flowers of spring. It was not by chance that Christ was born in a stable. What is the world but an immense stable where men produce filth and wallow in it? Do they not daily change the most beautiful, the purest, the most divine things into excrement? Then, stretching themselves at full length on the piles of manure, they say they are enjoying life. Upon this earthly pigsty, where no decorations or perfumes can hide the odor of filth, Jesus appeared one night, born of a stainless virgin, armed only with innocence. First to worship Jesus were animals, not men. Among men, he sought out the simple-hearted. Among the simple-hearted, he sought out children. Simpler than children and milder, the beasts of burden welcomed him. Though humble, though servants of beings weaker and fiercer than they, the ass and the ox had seen multitudes kneeling before them. Christ's own people, the people of Jehovah, the chosen people whom Jehovah had freed from Egyptian slavery, when their leader left them alone in the desert to go up and talk with the Eternal, did they not force Aaron to make them a golden calf to worship? In Greece, the ass was sacred to Ares, to Dionysus, to Hyperborean Apollo. Balaam's ass, wiser than the prophet, saved him by speaking. Oxus, king of Persia, put an ass in the temple of Ptah and had it worshipped. And Augustus, Christ's temporal sovereign, had set up in the temple the brazen statue of an ass to commemorate the good omen of his meeting on the eve of Actium, an ass named the Victorious. Up to that time, the kings of the earth and the populace, craving material things, had bowed before oxen and asses. But Jesus did not come into the world to reign over the earth, nor to love material things. He was to bring an end to the bowing down before beasts, the weakness of Aaron, the superstition of Augustus. The beasts of Jerusalem will murder him, but in the meantime, the beasts of Bethlehem warm him with their breath. In later years, when Jesus went up to the city of death for the feast of the Passover, he was mounted on an ass. But he was a greater prophet than Balaam, coming not to save the Jews alone, but all men. And he did not turn back from his path, no, not though all the mules of Jerusalem brayed against him.
To sing Angels We Have Heard on High.
A New Kind of Commander-in-Chief by Shane Claiborne. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." Ah, yes, the good old Christmas story. It conjures up warm feelings of Christmas pageants, eggnog by the fire, and that shimmering Christmas tree we have all grown to love. The opening words of Luke's Gospel have become a fixture in the liturgy of American cultural Christianity. Rather than shaking us to the core, as it did to those poor shepherds, the story of Jesus' birth has been tamed and now sits nicely in front of cheesy Hallmark greeting cards, which you eventually just throw away. But Luke's words instilled much courage and hope in Jesus' followers. To those managing the affairs of the state, they were grounds for arrest. So many of the words we just throw around in Christian circles today were loaded with political meaning for Jesus and his contemporaries. Many were words Jesus swiped from the Imperial Dictionary and spun on their heads in beautiful political satire. Consider these words: gospel, faith, throne, kingdom, Lord, banner, and Messiah. These are words that Rome knew well, and so do we.
Oh.
Kick it off, Lynn and youth, head down for some cake. Kids first.